So now we're going to move into the defined section of today's course, but before we dive in, I'm going to briefly give you an overview of the SBC flowchart so you know a little bit more about what that means. So the SBC flowchart is Breakthrough Action's design process for developing SBC activities to address health and development challenges. The flowchart draws from and incorporates learning strengths and methodologies from five different disciplines, including social and behavior change communication, design thinking, behavioral science, community development and engagement, and marketing science. So phase one is the define phase, and in the define phase, we're assessing existing knowledge and information and really focusing on deepening our understanding of the problem and its complexities. And we do this by establishing empathy with beneficiaries and various stakeholders and influencers to really uncover new perspectives and insights that are going to inform the development of the SBC activities. Then in phase two, the design and test phase, we build from that deeper understanding that we developed in phase one to ideate and refine and prototype different solutions with communities and key stakeholders. So this is really a developing and testing not yet final versions of potential ideas and concepts within the context where those solutions would be applied. And then once we've synthesized testing feedback into a prioritized suite of solutions, then that's when we move into the third phase, the apply phase, to start progressively implementing those solutions with a lot of real-time monitoring and evaluation to assess their success, and also most importantly, to continue to adapt and refine those solutions to improve them during scale-up. So the design process never ends, if you will, but that is a very broad overview of the flowchart, which I hope will help orient you as we go through the rest of the sections in today's presentation. And with that, I will pass it back off to Utra.
Hello, and welcome back. We're going to talk a little bit about the flowchart in the second segment, which is a phase that we call define. And in this phase, we want to discuss the SBC flowchart and how we might look at existing knowledge. Do you board a plane and decide where to go? Seems like a silly question, right? You never do that. You probably decide where you want to go and then board the correct plane. But oftentimes what we end up doing is we decide the path we want to take or the approach we want to use without really thinking about where it is we want to finally go, right? What is our goal? What is our vision? Why does a country program decide on SBC interventions to be used before deciding where they want to end up? They say, let's do posters, let's do radio programs. Is that the right vehicle? Is that the right airplane to be flying? Should it be is that the best airline, right? So to decide the right airline to use and which where you want to board it, one needs to really understand where you want to end up first. So think about our fictional country X. Adolescents aged 15 to 19 have a high rate of pregnancy. About 55% of girls become pregnant by the age of 19. The Ministry of Health is concerned about their early age of childbearing and the implications for the health and well-being of young girls entering motherhood, in addition to the concerns about their completion of education and their employment opportunities. Fair, right? Ideally, where we want to go is what? Not reduction of teenage pregnancies by 5% or 2%. No. Let's think big picture, big sky. No unplanned pregnancies in girls under 19. That could be our big sky. This is the gold standard, the shared vision. We all want that, right? Families want that. Governments want that. NGOs want that. The girls want that, right? We hope so. Unplanned pregnancy. So if a pregnancy is not planned, then it is something that we want to address. This is the shared vision. And unless we start with the gold standard, we can't define the path between here and there, right? We can't know where we'd like to ideally go. If we want no unplanned pregnancies in girls under 19, where are things now? Where are things now? And why is there a difference between where we are now and where we want to go, where we want to be, right? Right now it's 55% of girls under 19 getting pregnant, and that's not what we want. So the difference is what we need to understand. Why is there a difference? So what questions, if answered, would help you figure out what to do to get there? What kind of questions might you ask? Pause this video and write down a few questions that might help you figure out how to get to your vision from where you are right now. So the first stage, really, we want to look at inquiry, analyzing the situation, analyzing the programs that are currently addressing teenage pregnancy, and what are the capacities of programs, what are the shortcomings, and so on, and analyzing our audience, right? What is the social or behavioral problem? We want to go beyond assumptions. We don't want to sit at a desk and make up what we think it is. We do want to do a desk review of existing information and formative research to fill the gaps where there isn't existing information and glean further behavioral insights to understand more about the behaviors. When we bring together the key behavioral insights around barriers and enablers for these young girls and collaboratively, then we decide where to begin or to focus. How do we collect this information that we need? Think about the following potential questions. What is the purpose of our inquiry? Who should be involved? Is it community-led? Are we looking for quantitative or qualitative data? Will the chosen methods generate the type of information that we need? Do we need to generalize? Do we need to generate a hypothesis or test a hypothesis? Who do we need to talk to? How many people? What are the analytical capabilities of our team? And how much time and resources do we have? We love to talk about this one philosophy at our center, which is the focus, demand, sacrifice. Sounds dramatic and sounds cruel, but the truth is we can't do everything well. And in doing everything, we may achieve nothing. So to focus and to achieve results, effective results, we do have to sacrifice the things that are nice to have, but not core and essential to this program. From the key insights that you've derived, pick the one to focus on first. Pick one. Pick one for different reasons. The criteria for choosing the one could be because it's the easiest one to tackle first, a quick win, low-hanging fruit. Or it could be a challenge that affects the largest number of people. Or it could be the challenge that is the hardest to tackle. You've got other things fairly under control, but this one is the toughest nut to crack and you want to address that. Or it could be a different criteria. But be clear about why you're choosing one, that one to pick and choose on that first. Consider the socio-ecological model. An individual's behavior is not just his or her behavior. It's influenced by a number of factors at the individual level, by the family and peers and networks, community, society, and the program. A program to overcome this, all of these barriers, normative and social, will only then lead to normative and social and behavior change, right? You cannot just address the individual and expect them to change their behavior. The barriers could be at any one of these levels, maybe more than one level. How do we address those barriers to make meaningful change? So for this, we need to segment our audiences to understand them better. I like to think of audience segment like an orange. So you have different segments and each segment has its unique characteristics. And audience segmentation can categorize the audience into logical groups to make a better fit between the messages and information and persuasion and this particular audience segment. Why do we want to segment audiences? Because we don't have unlimited time and resources, right? We have to spend what we have effectively. There's also a trade-off between reach and intensity. I like to think of it this way, like a piece of butter on a piece of toast. You can either spread it thin and across the whole piece of bread, or you can have it thick and have it just on one piece, one part of the bread slice. right? So if you can't have the same amount of thickness everywhere because that's all you have is one pat of butter. So there's a trade-off between reach and intensity. You can either reach a lot of people with a little information or a small group of people with a lot of intense information. And when you segment audiences, you can do that intense reach better. Different people may have different information needs. Their own unique characteristics may be different. And different people may have different tastes, values, worldviews, sense of humor, or preferences. And almost always, it's not the same as your own. So we're not designing programs for us. We're designing programs for our audience segment. And we have to remember that. We deal with a wide range of human behaviors, cultures, values, beliefs, literacy, message preferences, media preferences, and so on. Who is the key audience segment for your behavioral challenge and why? Think about that. Who is the key audience segment for your behavioral challenge and why? And what change do you want this segment to make? Let me give you an example from COVID. Say you discover that most of the COVID infections are happening in public transport in your city, especially buses where masking is not consistent or correct. So in this example, where do you want to go? Everyone on the bus is consistently and correctly masked to minimize the spread of COVID-19 in that environment. This is your gold standard. This is where you want to go. This is your vision. Where are we now? What's the behavioral or social problem? People on public buses in City X are not masking correctly and consistently, and therefore facilitating the spread of COVID-19, right? So they're not masking, and that's the behavioral and social problem. Who is your audience segment of focus for this intervention? They are the commuters and the passengers on the public bus who are not wearing the mask correctly and consistently. They are not the ones who are wearing the mask. So you further segment your passengers into those who are and who are not wearing masks. And what change do you want these non-maskers to make? You want them to wear a mask consistently and correctly when they're on the bus. That's the behavior you want them to practice, right? So we'd love for you to work through this scenario, this sort of an example. And in our scenario, the adolescents aged 15 to 19 in country X, having a high rate of pregnancy, 55% of the girls become pregnant by the age of 19. The Ministry of Health is concerned about early age of childbearing and implications for the health and well-being of young girls entering motherhood, in addition to concerns about completion of education and employment. What we'd like you to do is, at the end of this segment, pause the video and consider, where do you want to go? What's your gold standard vision? Where are we now? What is the social and behavioral challenge? Who is your audience segment of focus for this intervention? And what change do you want this segment to make? Now, remember that if the social or behavior challenge may not be related to the audience that is beneficiary. It may not be the young girls. It may be the service providers who are not counseling empathetically. It might be that the parents or the families of the young girls are not supportive. It could be that they don't have self-efficacy. It could be any number of reasons. So you have to be careful to understand who your audience segment is, whose behavior you want to change, right? So the beneficiary may be the young girl, but is she the audience for our intervention? Something to consider. So we invite you to work through this exercise, this first exercise, and answer these four questions on your own.